Okay. Are we live?
Yeah.
No problem.
Okay. Can some people go on mute and I can start? Yeah. Okay. Good evening, Ascenters and entrepreneurs. Thank you so much for joining us today as we start the second series of webinar called Ask the Expert from Ascent that we bring to all the entrepreneurs. Today we are planning two in a week, and the first couple of series we are bringing in partnership with some of the partners that we've been working for a long time. We have today with us CFO Bridge. We have had Srini from the founder of CFO Bridge with us in the first series as well. A quick introduction about Srini and Gautam, who's joining us today from CFO Bridge. I'll do a quick introduction and then I hand it over to Srini and Gautam to take it forward. Srini is the founder and partner for CFO Bridge and has been an accountant for about 30 years of total experience, of which about 24 years have been in successful corporate career as CFOs of large and diversified enterprises. Srini has also the proven ability to partner business in key strategic and functional leadership roles across multiple industries.
Time out.
Like oil and gas, life and general insurance. Hi, Shravana, can I request you to go on silent, please? Yeah, thank you. I'm also pleased to introduce Gautam, who's the partner of CFO Bridge. Gautam is a chartered accountant himself with more than two decades of work experience with reputed organizations such as Marico, Kaya, Raymond, Amway, and the Piramals, of which 13 years have been in leadership role. Gautam has also worked closely with reputed CEOs and is adept at balancing growth and financial controls through his understanding of business drivers and in-depth knowledge of finance. So welcome once again, Srini. We are going to discuss cash flow management today, and I hand it over to Srini and Gautam to take it forward. Over to you guys.
Thank you, Archana. Just checking is the audio and the video of mine is clear. Okay, awesome. Yeah, good evening, Ascenters. That's how you are described. It's always a pleasure meeting people and talking, sharing our views. So we were the first one to present something in, you know, as soon as the COVID struck. And then we went through certain strategies, certain thought processes. And now, you know, it's about 3 months time. I'm sure that you're all, there's a lot of very tiresome webinar sequence. There is a webinar for everything. And therefore there are, you know, we were just webinar jumping from one webinar to the other. But you know, we wanted to actually be of some use and some incisive thoughts to bring it to you, and that's why we took some time with Archana and Asen to think through and then put together this thought process. So I am fairly sure that you will hear something interesting from us, and we will we would like to, you know, share some thought process. So what I am going to do is quickly, you know, about in about 30 minutes time between me and Gautam, we will share some thoughts and the presentation. I'll go to the presentation now. The presentation will be in two parts. You will have the first part is about emerging economic scenario and opportunities, and second part is a little bit about business and also more about the finance and cash flow strategies. So I will cover them as elegantly as possible. Any questions are welcome. There are some questions that Archana has already read out to us, and we will ensure that we address them as we are talking, you know, in either in mine or in Gautam's one, or we can talk about them as well. So COVID has actually struck us, and here is where we are. right? I think all of you might have even seen this model. This is where, you know, it all happened, and you know, so in some sense, you know, this and the next slide that I'm going to talk about on economics, both of them are actually, you will find a lot of similarities between this side and side. Both side has got a valley, and then it is a normalization back to this. So you can imagine where, I'm sure that many of you would have learned about Kubler-Ross curve model. When something just strikes you, that's where we are. I think now we should be through the trough, and we should be either experimenting, or we are deciding, you know, we are accepting as they are things, and we are trying to do new things, and then integration, and then, you know, we will get back there. This is very crucial to understand. This is very important, because economics at the end of the day is all about perception. You know, if all of us feel that, you know, that the economy is doing well, you know, it's generally, you know, people ask you, how are you doing? And, you know, I used to answer, oh, I'm fine, and all those things. In about 20, 30 days ago, I actually stopped, and I was wondering, am I really fine? So I actually changed my answer. I said, I am safe. That's the answer that I gave. And slowly, you know, I also started thinking through that. And then I said, oh, acha, how I'm actually saying I'm fine. Because I'm learning to live with this. So I think it is, as more and more people are traveling through this, you know, the kind of perception journey, economics reflect same thing. And in fact, this is actually what OECD has done. The green line, what you are seeing, is what was predicted about, you know, a year ago, a couple of quarters ago, they predicted that there will be a small. So we had we now have what is called a single hit scenario, which is a sharp V. And I, you know, you cannot see that, you know, the demand is, the numbers are, the curve is still well below 100, even end of Q3 2021, for a very long time. This for India could be slightly different. We are the advanced countries. Now, everybody is actually talking about a double hit scenario. If there is a double hit scenario, the second V will probably go down a little bit. It won't be all that bad, but the recovery is going to take longer. So we got to keep this in mind, because there is no clarity in anybody's mind as to where we are. All that we have clarity is, you know, there is a problem and how we are going to adapt it. The government, everyone has said, right? I think, you know, last time when we spoke, there were hardly about some 3-5 cases in Mumbai, probably less than that. Now we have close to about 100,000 cases. And cars, and there's more businesses still opening up. It's about, I think you have to conquer the fear first, and then the economy actually happens to you. So that's sort of the sets is essentially, it's about it's more about mind game. Now let's talk about a little bit of, you know, this graph. You know, it came in about a week or 10 days ago in the Mint newspaper. You could see that, you know, electricity generation is getting there. The EV bill data, which is sort of telling you the traffic on the national highways, is getting better. The traffic on JNPT is improving. The motor vehicle sales have picked up. There's something which is getting sold. May not be the passenger vehicles big time, but two-wheeler sales is back in the line. Agricultural tractor sales are happening. So, and unfortunately, you know, air quality, which is an index of lifestyle, but it seems to be more an index of economic and industrial activity. So the worsening of the air quality is cited as a show of economic recovery, but you know, it's a good and bad thing. I will not talk more about that. And then, you know, the National Rural Jobs Fund. I think, you know, today also they had an article saying that it is rain job rural areas. And we are seeing too very clearly the impact is in pockets. Chennai, Mumbai and Delhi are in pockets. The rest of the country is really inside every year to do things. So let us keep that in the context. The economic growth and recovery are slowly happening, and it is going to follow a very long curve to get to normal. Then the GDP growth is definitely going to fall, and you know, you all would have seen so many tables yourself, and everyone has given a rate and of growth. I mean, it is anybody's guess right now, but one thing is very clearly visible is that there is going to be a degrowth, and you know, India is going to degrow, the world is going to degrow, and possibly in 2021 we are going to, you know, so let us keep in our mind that financial year 2021 is, I think we definitely talked about it, that we need to survive the 3 or 4 months of lockdown. That's what we talked about it in the first seminar. The second seminar is also saying you are through the survival, but now it's about, you know, managing the cash flow and then, you know, sailing through the rest of the FY 2021. And then in 20, there will be growth coming to us. That's what is clearly visible. Now let's get into look at some other sector, the, you know, section of the cross section of the data. You know, on this side you will see in the table on the left side, you are seeing India's trade balance by country. Trade balance means how much we are importing, how much we are exporting. What is the net? Okay, India is a net negative current account deficit of $157 billion, of which you can see the big daddy is sitting on top. That is the China. We are exporting $17 billion, which is probably a lot of stuff like raw materials and wars. And then there is, you know, we are importing a whole lot of things, $68 billion, leaving a net negative of $51 billion. And then there are, you know, there are other countries. Now, and what are we importing? We are importing oil. We all understand oil is a crucially required thing. And gems we are, but gems is coming in and going out as exports. But we all know that there are so many things which are we are importing. I mean, you know, it is a favorite topic of mine to say that even our own Ganesh Murthy, we were absolutely okay for it to be made in China. You know, you go to any major tourist attraction, you go to Eiffel Tower in France, or you go to any other major, I think even Taj, excepting probably the Taj replica, you go globally, most of the tourist art, you know, the what we call as the souvenirs, they're all made in China. You know, are they going to remain like this? Are they going to change? So we left too many things for manufacturing to China, and that's where I think import substitution opportunities are existing hugely across the spectrum. In India, what happened is we sort of, you know, we had less importance on manufacturing. We were quite comfortable with trading, you know, buying it. So we became a big trading nation, you know, buying from China and selling it to our people in here. So it actually upset a lot of things. So the point that I want to drive is, as SMEs, as you know, traditionally manufacturers, it is our responsibility to manufacture back in India, and this needs to happen. So let's not look for, you know, whether the manufacturing will shift from China back here, but there is a whole lot of things that import substitute opportunities available here. So that's what we need to look at it. That is more than Atmanirbhar. You know, if you are looking for to come and as shifting is going to happen, that's one point. But there are lots of things which we can actually do import substitution here. Because China thing, the MNCs and others are going to look at various variety of things. You know, this morning I read that Fox thing from China, and the government of India has told them, you know, come here, we will give you everything else, you set it up here. Foxconn is a Taiwanese company. There is no reason for them to be in China. They are going to be here somewhere in India. You know, whether we'll find a place and they will come here. And those kind of things are happening. But how are we going to benefit as SMEs, right? I think, you know, that's very important to see. You know, in the past, there are other guys who are going to compete as well. Vietnam is going to compete. Indonesia is going to compete. Philippines is going to compete. And even Bangladesh, Burma, all of them are going to compete, and we are going to get lesser of that. Notwithstanding, there is going to be a huge opportunity coming from the shifting also. And, you know, it's up to the SME manufacturers to seize the opportunity and move forward. So that's about the opportunities. But let me, I talked about FY 2021, the pain. The pain is, you know, all of you might would have probably seen the print article, but you know, it's an interview in the print with Manish Sabharwal. And he talked about the pain. Pain is yet to be fully, you know, sort of seen. There is going to be pain, okay? The MSME sector, according to CRISIL, there is going to be a degrowth of between at least 20% in the FY 2021. EBITDA is going to be lower. The good thing is there is going to be EBITDA. You know, about this EBITDA and all those things, what I want to tell you, there is a very important thing about fixed assets and fixed costs. And that's what, you know, Gautam will cover. But I do want to share with you an article by McKinsey. Just give me 1 second. There is a small challenge here. Yeah, here is it. I think Archana, are you able to see this slide?
And yes, yeah. I'm able to see it, Srini.
So I assume that you are able to see. I am showing, you know, yeah. If you are able to see, I think what is very important is the guys are saying that there is a significant composition of a fixed cost. And here is an exhibit that, you know, McKinsey has shared, that cross-sector average of at least about 50% on fixed costs. In service sectors, it's very, very high. About 70% of the costs are fixed costs. And manufacturing has got about 20-30% cost of fixed costs. And very important point made is about debt service coverage ratio.
Your voice is cracking a little bit.
Companies had even less than 1.5 of debt service coverage ratio. Okay. If it cracks again, do tell me. I will move closer to the Wi-Fi station. Yeah. I actually moved it very close to me now.
Okay.
So if it cracks again, do tell me. I'll take a 10. So if you will, just hang it there. I am actually moving myself to just right next door to the Wi-Fi session, making some adjustments. Everybody knows that these are things that happen in working from home. So you know, we are used to this. So is this any better?
Yes, much better, Srini. Please go ahead.
Can you see me properly?
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. So I continue from here. So so there are two issues that we need to talk about, which Gautam will address. Okay. One is about the high incidence of fixed costs, as a result of which volatility in earnings and demand not being there is going to have significant issue on the balance sheet. It is just making the balance sheet not so resilient. Balance sheet resilience basically means a high gearing, a low level of cost. I think these two things are combined. It makes balance sheet not more resilient. And that's something that we're going to talk about. Okay? So the MSMEs are going to feel, because we did not focus on them, not make those mistakes again and again and again. That's the point that I have been harping in any of the forums that I was saying. Let's focus on fixed cost. Cost have a nature to just grow and the creeping cost follow a very creeping route, and then we need to keep a complete them. Very important to manage the quality. And if there, and we'll discuss that in a lot more. And what is where the impact is high, what are the industries where the impact is medium high, and what are the industries where the impact is low, and how they have responded. I think we can discuss the actual strategies, then we will actually know. So, you know, the government has given an economic package. many of you would have read about it much more in detail. All that I want to say is there are monetary and fiscal stimuluses that we expected. What the government did more was providing more of fiscal stimulus. They did not do anything on the monetary side, which means basically the government came with a very smart program of giving guarantees, and on that basis, they said that look, your central credit line, 3 lakh at least about a month ago, and we are seeing that as of date, about 40,000 crores are sanctioned. And this morning news is that about 30,000 crores have been disbursed against the 3 lakh crores. Only 10% discussed, and this loan is called an emergency loan. And it seems to be an emergency for SMEs. It doesn't seem to be an emergency for anybody else. So, SMEs, we can lock the doors of the bank. We need to use the social media, and we need to use every single lobbying setup to tell the government that the banks are applying various kinds of rules. They are looking into the credit rating. And then they are not even giving the 20% that is done. They are covering. They are telling you take the 20%, but then repay some of the earlier existing loan. And there are some bankers which understandably they are asking you to take some life insurance policy and stuff like that. My recommendation is do not fall into any of those things. This is our right, and we need to get this done. It has to be delivered to the SMEs in exactly the way the government wanted it to be delivered. The only thing that we can do is we can lobby, and then we have got a very powerful social media in our hand, and we need to go through this again and again and again. We need to represent so that it happens at some point of time in the right manner in which it needs to happen. So if there are any questions on this emergency collateral free credit line, we can talk about this. I'm sure that you know that these things have happened. So, this is very, very important for remaining liquid and passing through this tough period. So, we talked about the global situation. We talked about the Indian situation. We talked about the SME situation. We talked about some of the opportunities that are available. We talked about how you should manage, you could get some of the credit. So, all these things that we talked about, then we now move on to the important stage of exactly what are the technologies, some of the techniques and tools that one should apply in managing the cash flow. So over to you, Gautam.
Yeah, thanks, Shini. So if we could go on to the next slide. Yeah, so I'll be talking about the business and finance strategies. So I would urge all the businesses to revisit their business and financial model. This is because we know that, all the businesses are facing huge challenges. And as they are addressing this particular challenges, their business models are getting changed. And as business models are getting changed, even the financial model has to change. So on the left-hand side, we have listed down some of the challenges which the businesses are facing. So first one is actually to implement a low-touch business model to win consumer trust. So this is, I think, the most number one priority for most of the organizations. So just to give you an example, if there's a restaurant of 1,000 square feet, which earlier had, say, 10 tables, now because of the new social distancing norm, it is able to lay down only 6 tables. Okay, so now this will now change the business model. This will have cost implications. The second thing what we're seeing is that the demand is falling. Demand will fall at least in the short term. This will have huge pressure on the profitability. We are also seeing that safety of staff, customers is very important. At the same time, a lot of migrant laborers are not available. The fourth problem is relating to supply chain. So most of the companies are trying to have a supply chain which does not have any disruptions, does not have, say, larger dependence on China. So even supply chain is a huge challenge which most of the businesses are facing. And then obviously on liquidity constraint, I need not speak more. So what is happening is that businesses are facing for the first time both demand as well as supply side challenges. So if you look at this particular scenario, this is no different from what a startup is facing. Okay, so we are actually incurring losses. And there are no solutions inside. So what do startups do? So if you look at the right-hand side, whenever there's a startup who is making losses, the first thing it does is that it goes back and looks at its unit economics. Okay, so we will urge all the members over here to go back and revisit your unit economics. Now, because of these challenges, your business models are changing, and it's important to again have a relook at the unit economics. So this would mean that you need to make an estimate of your revenues, and then based on the revenues also align your costs. Now, how the costs are to be aligned, I have a separate slide on that. But different companies have adopted different approaches. So there are corporates who are questioning the need of, say, a big office. There are different organizations who are taking pay cuts. But at the end of the day, it's very important to align your costs with the revenues which are expected. The second point is about rationalization. Since we all know that the capital which is available is limited, all the businesses are having a relook at their portfolio. So you could have different businesses, you could have different products, stores, geographies, costs, okay, but the capital is limited. So most of the businesses are having a look at it and deciding that which are the areas where they would like to invest. Now, there are a lot of companies, especially in industries such as travel or event, where there is no business happening and the expectations of business starting is also quite grim in the coming months. So we see that there are a lot of businesses who have taken a pause. So all the staff of these particular companies have gone on leave without pay, with the understanding that once business resumes, they'll be again called back to work. So we've seen a lot of businesses taking a pause. At the same time, Shini had shared that in the CRISIL report, they have said that during the current time, there might be 15 to 20% of the MSMEs who may not survive. Okay, so in this particular situation, a better thing would be to divest. M&As might actually go up, and there could also be a lot of shutdowns in the business. Next slide, please. Now, I think businesses went to sleep in the physical world and woke up in a digital world. Okay, so I think this pandemic has been a wake-up call as far as adoption of technology is concerned. Because earlier I used to remember, you know, if there were investments in technology, there used to be so many discussions about, you know, where is the ROI. But right now, technology is no longer optional. Most of the companies have to adopt technology. Technology has to be adopted for growing your top line and for your profitability. And we've also seen that customers have adopted technology pretty fast. Even 2 years back when we had demonetization, we had actually vendors using, street vendors using Paytm. So even right now we are seeing that, a lot of customers have adopted technology, but at the same time, there are a lot of corporates, especially manufacturing MSMEs, whose idea of digital is very far behind as far as the market is concerned. So here I think we'll have to engage an expert and leave it up to them to have a strategy as far as technology is concerned. Now, why technology? So we are seeing that technology has been adopted in different situations. So we presented some use cases over here. So while we know that video conferencing solutions are being used for, staff meetings and webinars, but we also seen a lot of companies having direct customer connects, through video conferencing. So we know there's Facebook Live, there are various ways of engaging with the customers through Instagram. We are seeing a lot of sales training, which used to happen, say, once in a year, with actually the entire staff all over India traveling to the head office. Now, even sales trainings are happening through video conferencing solutions. There are dealer conferences which are happening through video conferencing. In fact, yesterday, Apple for the first time had its developer conference, which was an online conference, and people all over the world could actually attend at the same time. So earlier, they used to have these events, physical events, and most of the world is actually now shifted to online solutions. The second point is, now your website and your social media will be your identity. So in the past, maybe there used to be all this foreign customers who used to come, used to see your factory, etc. But now with all the restrictions, your website and social media will be your identity. Maybe you need to have a nice virtual tour of your factory, products, services. So I spoke about the low touch economy. So can you actually have a video where you're demonstrating, how you will ensure safety for your customers? So a lot of companies have adopted the digital way of working. We are also seeing that, our entire staff is operating from home. So how can you actually monitor? So how can you actually monitor the performance, productivity of your employees? So we have CRM systems, we have HRMS apps, which kind of provide a dashboard on performance of, at the customer point and usage of the staff. The next point I would like to talk about is inventory management systems. Now, this is very relevant for a lot of manufacturing companies, and we know the pains they go through. Okay, so they have challenges in terms of identifying, what is actually their non-moving stock. The entire supply chain can actually be automated. So in this pandemic, one thing what we have seen is that a lot of companies have migrated to on the cloud accounting system. So earlier, otherwise it was, a desktop version of Tally. So now at least they have moved on to a cloud-based accounting system. And as far as technology is concerned, I think we see a lot of companies embracing digital marketing. Yeah, and as per one CRISIL report, rest of the mediums of advertisements will degrow in the current year by 25%. Digital marketing is the only sector which is expected to grow. And so this provides a direct connect with your customers. And also we are able to measure the ROI of all the digital marketing spends. So now I think in every finance presentation, there will be a slide on free cash flows. I think this is quite critical. So we all know that the market has not been very kind with companies who had a very high debt situation. Okay, so I think it's very important for all the companies to focus on their free cash flows. So the traditional way of measuring performance of the companies is to measure the ROC. But what we're recommending in the current situation is that companies should move from ROC to a free cash flow model, which I'll just illustrate in a few minutes. But before that, I think it's very important to align that, that there is a fundamental issue if the business cannot generate cash. Okay, so that's the principal reason for the existence of a lot of corporates. And say before the pandemic, if there were issues in terms of generating cash for the business, so then the whole point is that how is the business going to survive, post COVID? Because, banks will be open in terms of providing you loans for working capital. But right now the situation is that, corporates or MSMEs are asking for loans just for survival. So once your business starts, it's very important to show a free cash flow. Okay. And when we monitor the performance of a lot of companies, we see that a lot of profit is actually blocked in inventory or the receivables. Yeah. So there is actually a profit on the P&L, but we see that the entire profit is actually blocked in the balance sheet. Now, one important point is that since we are predicting that the top line would go down in the coming quarters, that would also mean that your working capital level should come down. And once that happens, you should see a release of a lot of free cash flow. Okay, so this is a very important thing to be kept in mind. So let me just explain the model of free cash flow. So the traditional way of measuring is to measure the ROC. So if you look at the first line in the table, so ROC is nothing but your profit before interest and tax divided by your investments in fixed assets and working capital. So in this particular scenario, say if the profits are 20 and your investments are 16 fixed assets, 14 working capital, so your return on capital is 20%. But this particular methodology hides a lot of inefficiencies which you might have in your inventory management or in your debtors. Yeah. At the same time, it's very important to focus on free cash flows. So only for this particular period, we are recommending corporates to monitor the free cash flow on the capital employed, which is illustrated in the second line. So say, for example, your profits drop to 50% of your normal profits and your working capital, instead of decreasing, increases by 5. So in this particular scenario, while your profit will come down to 10, the increase in capital, working capital is 5. So in this particular scenario, you are able to generate a return on your capital employed of just 5%. Now take another example, the last example, where the profits are 50%, but you're able to reduce your working capital by 15. Now in this particular case, you've generated free cash flows of 25 and your ROC is 29. So this is one methodology we would recommend for all the clients to follow. Next slide, Chini. I have a couple of slides on the financial management, which requires a complete revamp. So we know today that the situations and assumptions are changing quite frequently. So having these multiple scenarios, backup plans, and agility in execution will be the key. I think we'll have to redesign our MIS reports for faster and better decisions. And the MIS has to include both financial as well as non-financial KPIs. Another important point is that I think in the current pandemic, it's also important to monitor your competitors' move. So there might be cases where the competitor is not able to survive. So that might actually change the entire dynamics of a particular industry. And hence, very important to also monitor the moves of your competitors. So on the right-hand side, we've listed down certain things as far as the costs are concerned. So I think in the last webinar, Srini spoke extensively on costs. And especially on manpower cost. But here we will urge you that since we have recommended that your model has to be scalable, I think it makes sense to convert your fixed cost into a variable so that as your business scales up, you're able to increase your cost, and if your business comes down, you're also able to reduce the cost. So models such as the outsourcing model, gig resources, is something which we highly recommend our clients to adopt. So I've spoken about review of office space, etc. Revisit structure, have leaner structures for faster decisions. But at the end of the day, I think a lot of activities have happened on the costs are concerned. So right now, what we recommend is that you have to align your costs with the expected revenues to the extent possible. Next slide. So my last slide is on working capital management. So as business open up and we start doing business, I think it's very important to revisit our credit policy. In the current situation, we expect that defaults are expected to rise. So in this particular situation, it's okay to sacrifice margins, but it's more important to get money in your bank. Okay, so in this particular situation, maybe you'll have to grade your customers into A grade, B grade, C grade. Maybe A grade can be those AAA or government organizations where money is secured. But in case of B and C grade customers, you will actually have to ask for some advance, etc. And obviously for B2C customers, it's always advisable to work with an advance, because even the cost of following up with B2C customers for a smaller amount might be pretty high. The next point is about managing your raw material, working progress and FG. So in many organizations, we have seen that, there is excess raw material which has been purchased. There are situations where the FG is manufactured, but, the customers are not lifting this particular material. Now imagine in this current situation where, we are short of cash, and if we are not able to manage the inventory, so that will be a big disaster for any organization. So I think a huge amount of attention will have to get into before you buy this particular raw material, before you convert into this particular FG. So what we say is that you need to monitor your inventory like you've never done before. And as I had shared in the previous slide, it's very important to monitor your free cash flows at the product level, at the service level, geography level, customer level, so you know where you are actually making your money. And on the right-hand side, we've listed some of the initiatives as far as treasury tax is concerned. So follow up for tax refund, apply for lower TDS certificates. If you're going to make a loss this year, no point actually keeping money with the government, and take full advantage of the schemes which have been announced by the government. Avail COVID loans, Srini spoke about it. You can discount your invoices of PSUs and AAA rated clients. So there's a Trex platform where there are actually players such as RXIL, which is owned by SIDB. So you can actually use all this means of discounting.
And one thing that, Gautam, most SMEs usually not really follow up is on the interest subvention scheme. For every SME, there is an interest subvention scheme is available. So the total interest that you are paying, the government actually subvents certain sum. You need to talk to your banker and you need to apply for that interest subvention. That can be a significant interest credit, but also we'll come back to you.
Yeah. So next point is that, review of non-core assets. So during this pandemic, when corporates were reviewing their balance sheet on the asset side, they actually found a lot of assets such as security deposits given to various authorities, bank guarantees which have got expired, etc. So these are all, or land which was purchased long back, so these need to be reviewed and monetized. We also believe that in the coming quarters, especially there'll be a lot of investment bankers who will commence this mergers and acquisitions activity. This will intensify in the coming quarters, and if one of y'all there could be an opportunity of either acquiring companies or just to survive, be acquired by someone else. Next slide.
Can we, Gautam, is it okay if we take a few questions now?
Well, I think
we are done.
Okay. In conclusion.
Yeah.
Sorry. Should we?
Yeah. Go ahead? So this is the conclusion slide. I think we both can talk about it. I think so FY 2021 is about survival. It's going to be muted. Everybody is saying demand will happen in the later part as of 2021 maybe. Okay. So demand decline in the short term is definitely certain. It is given. So, Gautam talked about techniques, about aligning cash flows and cost structures to ensure that we are surviving. We need to make at least two, three scenarios of cash flows and the profit and loss account, just to see that we will survive even if you are pressure testing the P&L, we have enough money to survive through this period. So yeah, lower your break-even point by converting fixed cost into variable cost and rework working capital cycle, free cash flow is better. And then there is something called increasing velocity of cash flow cycles, right? There is procure to pay cycle, there is order to cash cycle, there is inventory cycle. So if your inventory cycle is, let us say lead time is normally 2 months time or a month's time or 15 days time, talk to your vendor and see whether you can actually bring it down. And if your manufacturing time, you know, you are used to having, you are used to operating safe with, let us say, 1 month of raw material stock. Can you operate with 15 days of raw material stock? You know, all these things you do to improve your the velocity of cash. And that is very important. And the focus on making balance sheet resilient. We talked about what makes balance sheet resilient, all the above. You lower your break-even point, you rework your working capital cycle, your balance sheet becomes resilient. Keep an eye on your debt service coverage ratio and, you know, and all the other important things for external lenders. And then, of course, ideate and implement on low-touch business model. What we have done, Archana, we have given, there is a separate website called low-touch business model. We found a very interesting presentation from them. We have adopted the presentation for Indian condition. We have attached about 4 or 5 slides on. So they are self-explanatory slides. They are attached with this presentation. So when you are circulating, the members can get them and they can go through that. And sure. We don't want to spend time on it right now, but they are extremely interesting ideas on what is called a low-touch business model and how anybody can do that. So we have given you some thoughts there. And then there is import substitution is a great opportunity that you can do that. And then there is uncertainty a bit about the epidemic requires continuous planning scenario building. We talked about it. Go digital to stay relevant and avail all benefits announced by the government from time to time. I think we got to do, there is no option that, you know, we do one or two of them. We got to do everything, all of them to stay relevant and to see through the tough times. And as I mentioned in my first slide, it's the economics and the, you know, is about the pandemic is also about fear. You know that the greed and fear are the two forces of economics. It's right now, it is all fear. So we got to do everything else to stay out of the fear. And then, you know, hopefully the economic automatically will sort itself out. So that's, those are the things that we want to say. And we can now take any
questions. Okay, so there are a few which have come. I will urge the participants to please type their questions in the Q&A section of the Zoom, and we'll take the questions now. So the one question from Heman Ruparel, he says, what modifications should the government do to the emergency collateral free credit line scheme so that it can widely be disseminated without getting into a loan waiver scheme few years hence?
Gautam, do you want to handle that?
Yeah, Gautam.
Yeah. So while the government has announced this emergency collateral free credit line, please remember that this is the extension of your current lines on which you would have already given a security. Okay. So what the government has said that earlier, if you had borrowed 100 rupees by giving a collateral of 50, now you can actually borrow 120 with the same collateral of 50. Yeah. And so I think the government has been pretty liberal in terms of coming out with this particular scheme. That's why Srini also insisted that most of the organization should avail this particular scheme, because otherwise rest of the bankers are going to ask for collaterals and other things, you know. So this is something which the government is trying to manage within its, you know, fiscal deficit itself. And so right now, I think the monitoring mechanism has been quite rigorous. And as Srini spoke about, just 10% of the total loan scheme has been disbursed. So there could be a chance of this particular loan getting bad. Okay, so the NPA levels of the banks are already pretty high, but this is actually something which most of the countries are doing, because it's a question of survival. Yeah, so this is the cheapest loan which is available to a lot of MSMEs without collateral. So we will encourage all the companies to actually go for this. And as far as loan waiver scheme is concerned, this fiscal deficit is already budgeted. I don't think the entire amount of 3 lakh crores will go bad. Maybe 10% or 15% of it will go back, which has to be financed by the government. But I think that's something which the government will finance.
Yeah, they have already provided for. So Archana, I want to handle one question posted in the chat section.
Sure.
By Upen Asher, he said in Economic Times there is a report on MSME receivable. It's a very interesting article actually. I also read that. In fact, I also wanted to talk about that. I forgot about it. Thanks for reminding, Upen. There are a couple of websites actually which are focusing on helping MSMEs to entertain their complaints about overdue receivables from companies. And there is a website called Samadhan. We can send you exactly the website links and we will circulate that with you. I forgot to include them, or we can include them in the website in this PPT, and we can send you this. One should never feel anything less about asking for their own money. It is money is owed to you. You are going to ask for it. You know, I don't feel. In fact, you know, there are times when I actually make a phone call myself. So there is nothing to be ashamed about. I think we need to do that. And there are so many things are available. Government has done a lot of things. There are websites which are now government has done to actually get the, and for a good change, this website has produced some amazing results. What we hear is 45,000 crores worth of receivable has been settled through this website, Samadhan website. We'll circulate the website exact URL of that, and that will be useful to you.
Sure.
Okay? So yeah, over to you, Archana, for the next.
Sorry. So the next question, it comes in two parts. One from Kumaran Mani. Would you suggest to buy own office space and move away from rental and convert the monthly rental to monthly EMI? Will leasing be a better choice than to own or rent?
See, definitely at this juncture, you know, we are already talking about not owning any fixed assets, and you know, so buying an office space is not going to be buying an office space which is giving you probably a 2% yield, as opposed to, you know, 2% yield is what, if that you are going to pay rental, you should pay. In fact, even office space you should really evaluate. Office is never going to go away. So working from home is nice, but that is for some period, you know. But we can evaluate how much space that we need. You know, do we actually, for incrementally small space, do we need to reserve a lot of space, or we can go and use a co-working station? All those things we need to evaluate. So I definitely, I'm not a fan of, buying office space for sure. I would say lease rental and then co-working station. They are all elegant alternatives. Yeah.
The second question, same from Kumaran, had been, would you suggest to convert the pay cut percentage to ESOP shares and retain the employees for, say, 3 years' time? Is that a good strategy or an idea?
It's a very good strategy. It's a damn good idea. I mean, you know, I have to, Kumaran Mani has given a very good idea. But I want to just improvise that idea, Kumaran. We have all seen ESOP in a listed company makes a lot of sense because there is liquidity. ESOP in an unlisted company may not make a lot of sense. So ESOP only as good as liquidity or monetization. So super question from you. I want all the industrialists to think about providing an ESOP scheme now. So reduce the salary, give them an ESOP scheme, and tell them after 3 years' time, I will buy you back. Because, you know, that reflects, your own, the owner's confidence. And it also provides a monetary way out for them. Provide some percentage or something like that. Provide some little bit of light on monetization of the ESOP. I think ESOP can work wonderful way. Superb idea from Kumar Mani. I really like that. I think, but ESOP should be always accompanied by a monetization. You provide a little bit of monetization, it can work wonders for you.
Okay. This is a question for Gautam. Gautam, can you explain FCOCE formula, the third example, one more time, please? Can you do that?
Want me to go to the PPT, Gautam?
Yeah.
Also, if you can take this other question also, Gautam, it says, what is the interest subversion you mentioned in the talk? Can you explain that again? Both, if you can do.
Yeah, so in this particular example, what we have actually stated is that businesses have to look at not only their profits, but also the changes in their working capital. Otherwise, what happens is that in most of the businesses, there is a profit and loss account and you declare that there is a profit. But most of the time we see that the business doesn't have cash because you would have sold something, but the entire money is locked in receivables. Yeah. Or the inventory valuation is a little bit inflated. So in the current pandemic, what we are seeing is that if your business earlier was say 100, and if you actually had a working capital, say of 50, and now if your turnover, say for example, is going to drop from 100 to 50, even your working capital has to come down. So a lot of release of cash has to happen from the working capital. Yeah. So all these aspects of working capital are never monitored by the company. Yeah. So in the third method, in the third line, what we have said is that while companies need to look at their profits, but at the same time, they also need to monitor what has been the changes in their working capital. Because the moment your working capital increases, that means somebody has to finance it. That means again, you'll have to go back to the bank and ask for extra money. So instead of that, can you actually generate cash flows by reducing your working capital levels itself? So in the third case, we have given an example where because of better working capital management, Shini spoke about, you know, the inventory cycles, etc. So if you're able to bring down your working capital by 15, then you would have not only generated a PBIT of 10, but also your changes of working capital is 15. That means the free cash flow which you've generated is 25. So we would urge the businesses to look at both these metrics as compared to just looking at PBIT. Now, this is something which we are recommending only in the pandemic. Okay, this is not a usual methodology which is used because over a period of time, what you show in your P&L, that's the amount of cash which you can generate at the end of the day. But in the current pandemic, since there is a lot of volatility and your top lines are going to go down, even your working capital is going to go down, we are recommending this particular methodology where you're not only measuring your profits, but also the changes in the working capital.
Right. Gautam, the second question from Praveen Shekhar on what is the interest subversion you mentioned in the talk? Can you
specify? Yeah, we talked about interest subvention. I talked about it.
Sorry.
Archana. So interest subvention is that if the interest on your CC or OD is about, let us say, 10%, the government of India gives you a subsidy on the interest. If you are an SME, registered SME in the Udyog Aadhaar portal, ranging between 1% to, I think, 1.5% or maximum 2% of this. So effective interest cost comes down to about 8%. For this, you need to apply to the government through your bank. Your bank has to certify and they will do an internal process. The money comes within about 60 to 90 days from the end of the year. So, and this is a critical source of income. And right now, everybody needs some money. So, this is a good thing to apply for.
The next question is from Pranav Lilani. How to get loans approved for new projects as there is no historical backing of for any projections at this point?
Right now, you know, you need to have a significant new. We just now went through. The emergency credit loan is not happening. So I really don't know. This is not a great time to start a new project and look for a loan for it. We got to have enough money on our hand. And if you have got, for example, if you have got a diversification, if you have got a running company, and if you are going to put significantly higher margin, you know, normal margins are about 20-25% the banks will expect. You are going to have a significantly higher margin. And if the company's credit rating is better, you know, minimum BBB and above, you have a chance of getting some loan, new loan from the government, from the banks. Right now, you know, there is something called credit aversion. Banks are, you know, that's what I told in the last Dena Bank, Dena Bulgaya. You know what I'm saying? The bank's job is to Dena. So, Dena Bulgaya, they are not giving. So, you know, so this is a huge problem right now. So, new projects are a problem. If you are satisfying all the other conditions, you may get a loan.
So there's too much surplus capacity in the market, I think, for new projects to come in. If you actually have money, then it's, I think, better to buy an existing company and run that company as compared to investing in a new project. Banks are unlikely to finance new projects.
Yeah.
Sorry. So to go back to the interest subversion one also again, Srini, there's an additional question. Is interest subversion applicable on loan taken in CEG or MSME or scheme?
I am not sure if we will get interest subvention for CGT SME scheme. It is subvention, V-E-N-S-U-B-V-E-N-T-A-Y-N, subvention.
Right. Okay.
So subvention is available. I'm not sure. I will have to check on whether CGT SME subvention is available or not. Maybe it is available on the base portion. CGT SME loans have got two portions of the interest. One is the base interest, second one is the extra premium that you pay for the credit guarantee scheme. So definitely you are not going to get any subvention on the credit guarantee scheme. Maybe on the base you will get. But I will clarify this to you. I will send you this answer. I will do some research and send you the answer.
Sure. My question from Manoj Rajan, is it good for companies to register as SMEs now, if not done yet, or it's only useful if it's done?
But do it now.
Okay, now. So register yourself right now. Next question from Manish Doshi. You mentioned M&A. Is this a good idea for an SME to build market share and capabilities during these times?
Gautam, I think you are a...
No, absolutely. If you can actually build a market share and capability in this current environment, then you would have done a fantastic job. You know, so that would actually mean that you have money in terms of pumping in the market and buying the market share. So if you are in that particular position, then as I said, you know, you can acquire companies. You will get them at a price never seen before. So a lot of companies are actually struggling. They're not able to continue retain. So in this situation, if you're able to pump in money, build market share, build capability, so there is a lot of staff which is available. There's a lot of talent which is available in the market. So the right time to pick up the right talent and, build a fantastic business for you. So I think that's the right thing to do, provided you have money in the bank.
Another question, does this additional loan guaranteed by the government apply to CC? I'll repeat the question. Does this additional loan guaranteed by the government apply to CC limits only or to existing term loans also?
It applies to both. It applies to both the term loans as well as, I think, as far as the term loan is concerned, if the 20% is applicable on the outstanding term loan. On the CC limit, 20% is applicable on the sanctioned limit. This has been our interpretation. I think most of the banks are also sticking with this interpretation.
Okay. Next question is from Afsad. To overcome liquidity for MSME, is it better to increase loans or OD or to opt for merger, sell stake in the company?
See, look, there are two different questions, right? I think, loan, you essentially do it for a short-term reason. A merger or acquisition, you do it as a very strategic long-term, reason. So you got to differentiate these two things. If your whole aim is just to survive FY 2020-21, by taking a little bit of more loan, COVID loan or things like this, we should do that. But as Gautam mentioned, that if you got a lot of assets, you are not able to make use of them, you believe that merger can make a better thing, then that is the time that you should really merge. You can't undo merger. It is not as easy as undoing typing in, the computer. So you have to really think through and do a merger. So merger and loan are not necessarily two options. They are two different.
I think he meant that he wants to sell a stake in his company to get the money. So raising money through debt or raising money through equity. Okay. But equity is a very long process. So if you're in need of funds, I think debt will be a much better option. The equity option tends to be quite time consuming, and at the end of it there is a valuation and there are too many actually processes involved of due diligence, etc. So if you start the process now, it might take a minimum of 6 months.
Yeah. So there are some questions in the Q&A section also, Archana.
We have extended. Yes, I'm reading through that only. We are at 5 o'clock. Is it okay if we extend it by another 50 minutes and take more questions?
I'm good.
Yeah, okay. So then we'll go ahead. There's a question from Rene. We are in the midst of taking the decision for our capital goods expansion, though I'm very confused right now. The first thought was to do it next year, would be looking good, but hearing mixed reviews. Do you think it is the right time to invest and should we borrow under the current COVID schemes or the existing banking provisions?
Capital goods expansion.
Yeah.
So, when he says capital goods expansion, he is for buying new capex, or he is in the business of producing capex, capital goods. He is not.
It's not. Rennie, if you are there, you can raise your hand and ask the audio question. If you are there, Rennie.
Yeah, somebody raised the hand.
Yes, somebody raised their hand. Can you allow that?
Participants raised their hand. That's what it says.
Don't know. Can somebody allow the Ruchika or Shravana? Can one of you allow the audio questions to be asked? Yeah, Rennie is here. Rennie, you want to ask that question? Go ahead.
Rennie's mic is muted.
Rennie, you have to unmute yourself at your end.
Yeah.
Yes. Go ahead. Ask the question.
Yeah. Hi. Hello, everyone. So my question is, we wanted to expand with respect to our capacity. We were thinking of catering to a larger volume. So in that case, we thought we'll put in some more capex and increase our capacity. But now I'm hearing that for some people are saying for 3 years the market is going to be down. Somewhere I get positive reviews that China is going to reduce their supply. More companies are coming in India. So in that case, should I actually wait until next year, or should I take the advantage and expand this year?
No. So what kind of a goods are you in, and what is the demand outlook for your goods?
Okay.
Is what is probably going to, determine you if you have to expand on the, what is the benefit that you are going to get? See, if you are going to expand, Rennie, right now, you are going to sink some amount of your money there, right? You are going to invest some money. So that money, you want to put it in the expansion, or you want to really leave it in the business of growing your business? That is the first. Second question is, what is the demand for the product that you are producing? If the demand is robust, you believe that the COVID will not actually, there are some products which are demand is going through the roof. For example, there is a CRISIL report, I'm sure that all of you would have read it. It was released exclusively for MSMEs. For example, we all know that Parle G case came and said that, look, my biscuits went through the roof. I produced, particularly Parle G was in a bad position pre-COVID. We all know this. And that's why I took Parle G's example. And they are now saying that, look, we produce so much biscuits we can never produce in our lifetime during this COVID time, because people are sitting at home, they are eating. That's the only explanation we can give. In those kind of things, if the demand is, the more, definitely, this is a good time to negotiate a very good price for the capex. You can actually go and put your terms. So some benefit you will get, you can go and tell the supplier of the capex and negotiate a very good price, and you can put it in there. So do you have surplus money? And do you have fantastic demand? Do you see this? If you see these two things, you should expand. But if your demand is for your goods is in question, and if you are going to significantly borrow, I think you should not expand.
Okay. Can Gautam? I see you offline just to get a better depth in this?
Yeah.
We can connect. Ruchika, please make a note to connect Rennie and Shrini on an email, please.
Sure.
Yeah. Can I go back to a question, Shrini, which had come beforehand from
sure.
Akshay Jain, and we discussed this. For a services company, the ideal cash in bank should cover how many months of fixed expenses? If there is a gap, is it must to secure working capital loan? If there is a surplus, should we invest in long-term funds?
Yeah, serious question. Good question. The service companies typically have a higher percentage of the revenue as fixed costs. I mean, that we saw that in the McKinsey presentation also. It is a bit difficult, but there are methodologies are available to bring down the fixed cost for service companies also. There's possible. So first of all, you should work on your fixed costs and bring it down. But essentially, you need to have at least, assuming that there is going to be working capital, receivable cycle is going to go through at least, between 60 days is going to be near normal, probably the new normal. So 2 to 3 months of fixed cost coverage you must have in liquid cash in your hand. If you have anything more than that, I would say right now you should keep everything in liquid cash only. Don't even think of long-term investment of your liquid cash. Don't even think of medium term, because bond market is undergoing significant volatility. And if you want to, cash is king right now. Don't even invest neither in medium term nor in bond market, nowhere else. Put it in liquid funds or better in fixed deposits. That's the best thing if you have got any money. 7 days, 15 days fixed deposit.
Right. Another question from Manoj Rajan. Can you give some ideas on the ESOP monetization methods for private companies? Is it good to not give any physical ESOP as it involves regulatory stuff, but only do a virtual ESOP?
No, so physical ESOP or virtual ESOP, there is no problem. There is no regulation there. The Companies Act has made it a lot more simple. You need an approved scheme for ESOP, but ESOP is generally, you know, there are 2-3 things there, right? Granting, vesting, and exercising. All that I'm saying is, you give to your employees an ESOP today in consideration for them reducing their salary. Tell them that, look, currently let us fix the fair value of the company, get an external valuer and value your company. External valuation doesn't cost you not more than 50,000-60,000 rupees. So get a valuation done. It's a fair value, so it has to be fair. And then from that time, let us say hypothetically, if the value is 10 rupees today, and at the end of the 3 years' time, if the fair valuation is high, I will buy it back at the fair value. Is one way of saying it. Or if you don't worry about the fair value, you can always say that, look, I will fair value, but a minimum guarantee of in 3 years' time, let us say for sacrifice, right? The bank interest is about 10%. So compounding rate of 3 years should come to about 30%, 35%. So you say, make it attractive, say 1.5 times I will buy it back. 10 rupees today, 15 rupees I will buy it back, minimum guarantee. Anything more than that, you know, the upside is to you, but I will provide at least 40 rupees, something like that. You make it, provide a buyback guarantee. That's what I mean by ESOP. It is a simple scheme. You can approach any practicing company secretary. They can get a ESOP scheme in place for a karcha of something like that. So within about 1 lakh rupees between the valuation and the company secretary, you can get a ESOP scheme up and running in place. And that's all. That's a one-time cost. You don't need any other further cost. There is no physical ESOP. There is no DMAT ESOP. No, it's not required. There's no problem on that.
There's a question from Viren. Is interest subvention applicable only for PSBs or even private banks?
Private bank. All banks. All banks.
All banks. Okay. A question from Hemant Gupta. Few customers take advantage of the situation to hold payment deliberately as government has relaxed norms. What do you suggest to do in such cases?
I think he is mentioning about government increasing the insolvency limit from 1 lakh to 1 crore.
Yes.
That is what he is. I think that was done for a different purpose. They didn't expect this kind of a thing will happen. See, look, collecting money is an art in itself. So I have done a 4-part podcast on receivable management and how to collect money. And the podcast is available in my website, www.cfobridge.com. It will go on for, it is a subject in itself. It can go on for at least an hour's time, all the 4 podcasts. I invite you to go to the website and benefit from the podcast. How to collect money from people who are deliberately delaying it. There are many techniques. So, go through my podcast. If you still have got any doubts, you know, you will find how to call me from Ascent. We can have a chat with you.
Samadhan scheme website address. Can you help, Srini?
I'll provide. I can't recollect it immediately. I will do that. I will include that in the website and send it to you.
Sure.
Right. Ruchika will post it. There are more questions from Munawar. Won't there be an opportunity miss if we are not optimistic? The general expected recovery is 2021. But if there is a V-shaped recovery with a conservative thought of presenting, cash may lose out. It's an observation, it's not a question. Anything you want to add, Srini or Gautam, here?
Yeah, so look, last time also, I was very optimistic. You know, when I presented, I had a slide on saying, just as how the pandemic came so quickly, it will also go away so quickly. That was one prediction. That has horribly gone wrong, right? That prediction is not right. The pandemic is here to stay. Even learned guys are saying that based on both what the pandemic is behaving and also based on how people are behaving with respect to spending the money. People are hoarding cash right now. So the broad-based recovery is not going to happen. So a V-shaped recovery may be there for a few things like consumer staples and other things. It's not going to be there for many other things. So I don't. I am now more sober. And I am a little bit more softened from my earlier aggressive stand or optimistic stand that there will be a V-shaped recovery. I don't see a V-shaped recovery as of now, personally.
Okay. There's too much amount of uncertainty, I think, in the market. So if there is a V-shaped recovery, we will ride upon that particular recovery. But at the same time, we should be prepared if there is say a W or a U-shaped recovery. That's what we are saying. We are not saying that let's not use the V-shaped recovery.
Okay. There's another question which was offline. Should you make lesser profits to get a positive higher cash flow?
Yeah, we said that.
We're discussing this.
If there is a, don't go below your variable cost, but you know, within the margin, so long as you are selling for a positive gross margin, if you can get your cash flow, go for it.
Okay. Another question. Does this I'll take this one because this has been done before. We of course need to give more details on the Samadhan scheme people. Given that there may be a V-shaped recovery, what financial planning is required? But you're saying there may not be a V-shaped recovery.
If it is there, then we should write it. I think, you know, you need to have cash to invest in working capital and ride the V-shaped recovery. That's what Gautam is saying.
Another question from Manoj. In private companies, can we get a loan based on shares as collateral?
In private unlisted companies, you can't do that. RBI does not allow.
Okay. Another question from Akshay. For a service industry, what's a good or expected day sales outstanding? What are the methodology to enhance recoverables, internal monitoring process, and client follow-ups?
So I have, there is my podcast. Please go to the podcast. There are a lot of tools, techniques, a lot of things are given there in that website, in CFO Bridge website. Yeah. And a good DSO, you know, it can be a tennis match between me and Gautam. I would say between 45 and 60 is a good DSO. Yeah, Gautam, do you agree or disagree?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, it also depends on your customers. As I said, if you are a service company and supplying to B2C customers, then you need to take money in advance. Okay. And I think the strength of your service also determines whether the customer will pay you in advance or 7 days or 30 days or 90 days. So there is no fixed answer for this. Okay. But the only fact is that lower the better.
Okay. There is one question from Upen, which he wants as an audio question. Ruchika, can we allow that? If he has raised his hand. Upen? Have you raised your hand so we can allow you to ask the audio question? And you can take Renny off the panel, please.
Yeah. Hi. Thanks a lot for allowing me the audio question. Srini, thanks a lot, for answering my question on today's ET and the muscle power that the corporates show for the MSME and, service industry, especially. Now, in extension, to what you have advised, I understand that for us to raise the claim or the issue with MSME under Samadhan scheme, we should have registered our credit agreement with MSME and also taken up at different milestones when the recovery is not happening, then only MSME is able to support is what is my understanding. Could you clarify on this?
So there are two websites, and the second website is actually clarifying a lot of things, even though you don't need to register this. The Samadhan website is the one that you need to do all those things, register. The MSME website, which, I got to tell you, the minister for MSME right now, Nitin Gadkari ji,
yes,
he's very active and very proactive, and he's taking a lot of very good steps right now. And he is even coming and clarifying the doubts. And because of him and his efforts only, the medium definition got reworked out. There is this MSME website is there. That's what I said I will clarify. There, you don't need to do anything else. Anything that you register, they are taking it as a complaint and they are working on it. That is... that's what we learned about it, and I will circulate those details via the Ascent at a later time.
Right.
Sure.
Thank you, Payne. So quickly, we're short of time. I'm going to quickly wind this up by telling people that we will be sending the presentation out. We will send you more links that Srini mentioned, including the Samadhan scheme, including the link to his podcast. Srini, if you can share that also with your permission, because people have asked for that on the chat as well. So we'll send all these details, as also the recording of this this webinar for people to go through it. That will come from Ruchika by end of day today. So thank you so much. Let me take this opportunity to thank Srini. As usual, a big help and lots of questions you end up taking. Thank you, Gautam, and welcome to the Ascent family, I think. Thank you so much for giving your time, and thank you to my team, of course, for putting this together. We have the next webinar on Friday on marketing under uncertainties, and we look forward to seeing you then at 4 o'clock again this Friday. Thank you, Ascent. Bye.
Thank you, Archana. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.